When I mention forensic science, you may think of popular TV shows that at the last minute get a breakthrough and win against all odds in the courtroom. Well, that may be Hollywood's version of forensic science, but what's the real deal? We're about to find out thanks to Ventura Perez, Associate Professor of Biological Archaeology in the Department of Anthropology at UMass Amherst, and the Ph.D. student who assists him, Heidi Bauer-Clapp. And she joins him today. Thank you so much for both coming on board to talk to us about this. What is forensic science? Because like I mentioned, it could be a very glamorized version that you see on TV. What is it in its true essence?
The word forensic simply means pertaining to a court of law, criminal or civil. It's as simple as that. So anybody who's providing evidence to either one of those courts is, in essence, doing forensic something. Forensic science is science's role of supporting the court. So it could be toxicology, pathology. Oh, there's different types of sciences that are doing this, but it's basically just helping the court come to a conclusion.
And Heidi, we were talking off camera about how when people see something on TV, they have a much different picture of it in their heads than when it actually happens in the courtroom and they're seeing forensic science happening right before their eyes. Talk about the difference.
It's much slower paced. Mm-hmm. The results don't come back nearly as quickly. The work tends to be much more tedious. There's more paperwork than those shows tend to depict.
Everything happens in an hour in this show, but obviously things are not happening in 1 hour when it comes to forensic science.
Exactly.
Now, the field school that you head up at UMass Amherst with the students, before we get into the details of what they do in the field school, do students kind of have a different perspective in their mind of what they think forensic science is, maybe from the TV shows or the movies they've seen and what it really is in real life?
Yeah, absolutely. Those shows really are the bane of my existence. I just struggle against them constantly. And students come in with this preconceived notion that they need to study anything with the title forensic in it. And what they really need to do is study the discipline that they want to work in and apply that to the courts. And that's a really difficult thing for students to begin to understand, because you know they're out there looking for anything with that word forensics in there so that they can get their foot in the door and try and do this for a living.
So once a student has kind of gotten past that gate where they know what they're getting into, they're not kind of distracted by the glamorousness of it, talk about the field school that both of you are a part of, where the students really get hands-on, literally, sometimes in the dirt, as they're getting into forensic science.
Well, the field school is really something very special and unique. I started the field school when I was a graduate student at UMass. And we didn't have any place to do it. We actually ran it out of a professor's backyard. And from there, I was fortunate enough to get hired by my department, and the university graciously gave some land to us so that we could formalize and create this field school. And it gives the students an opportunity, as Heidi says, to slow things down. But more importantly, it allows them the opportunity to make mistakes, because we construct the burial and we construct the pseudo crime scene. In real life, you wouldn't have that opportunity to make those mistakes. And so they get to ask the questions and they get to decide what they are going to excavate, what they aren't going to excavate. And at the end, they produce a product. And Heidi does a wonderful job taking them through that process.
And it's not just sitting in the classroom looking at a textbook. They're actually out there in the dirt, in the field, rain or shine, no matter what the weather is. What have been some interesting stories that you've had from students being out in the field, some things that have happened that are kind of like, oh, this is a good one?
Part of what we try to do with this course is to give students a very realistic sense of what it's like to work in the field. There's bugs. There's probably not going to be a bathroom facility, things like that. When you're out in the field on a daily basis, what are the things that you need to be sure that you're okay with? And the weather is a big part of that. This past summer, we were out in the field with the students for 14 days, and it rained for at least 12 of those days. And so we had 3 days straight where the students were taking paper cups and bailing 18 inches worth of water out of their excavation units, and then frantically digging and taking notes as quickly as they could as the water gradually seeped back in and things started to float away. So it gave them a very realistic sense of the challenges that you face when you do this work, and it also gives them a sense really quickly of whether or not they love this work enough to face those challenges and overcome them.
And it helps them see this is really what it is as opposed to what I've been seeing on TV or in a movie. Now, talk about the difference, Ventura, between forensic science and forensic anthropology.
Well, the anthropology falls under the umbrella of forensic science. Okay. So anthropology is a science, and specifically what forensic anthropology does, the discipline as a whole, is apply itself, again, to helping the court come to a decision on a particular case, whether it's a criminal case or a civil case. So there are different types of forensic anthropology. What we primarily do is biological anthropology. So we're looking at skeletal material and trying to ascertain how that person died and whether or not a crime was involved.
And you've written a lot about this topic as well. Talk about that.
Well, yeah. One of the things that my research looks at interpersonal and institutional forms of violence, so the mechanisms that allow violence to take place. And I work with both extant populations, living people, recently deceased, and archaeological material. So some of the work that I do is in Ciudad Juarez, looking at cartel violence, and a form of violence that I refer to as performance violence. And these are individuals that have been dismembered or beheaded. A lot of my students think that must be forensic anthropology that you're doing, and it's not. It's simply the study of violence, because I'm not helping law enforcement build a case against the cartels. On the other hand, Heidi and I were both involved in an international repatriation between the American Museum of Natural History in New York and the Yaqui Nation, a tribe in Mexico and in the United States, straddles the border. This is one of the first international repatriations. Even though this was an archaeological site, even though the massacre took place in 1902, because I was an expert witness, that technically is a forensics case. And that really starts to blow my students' minds, because they're like, wait, no, that's just archaeology.
Wow, great. Ventura, Heidi, thank you so much for giving us this information.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.